Biff's Gaming Videos. Joysticks and joypads.
Trackballs and mouse pads.
Swimmers and my guns.
Fun.
Alien invasions.
Robotic invasions.
Dungeons and dragons.
Fun.
Home runs and touchdowns.
Jungles and ghost towns.
Videos from Biff's son.
Fun.
This is the 2017 Free Play Florida, held in Orlando, Florida around Thanksgiving. If you come in the front door of the hotel here, it's the Pinball and Arcade Show. It's open to the public. You go to the left here and you pay them their $35. And then you had to pay parking as well, which you were parking way over near SeaWorld. way far away, and then you had to pay this and that. It's just a lot of things you wanted to sell, like in here people are selling stuff. You had to pay money to go in to buy stuff. Now I think they should have moved where you pay to this next door we're going to go through, so that the people in the hotel can come in for free and buy stuff. You know, people just selling their stuff here, you know, little pictures and things. At the end here were some people that wrote video games, and they were showing them off. That really should have been in the main hall with the other stuff, which we'll see in a bit. So you go in the main thing here, and there's Billy Mitchell from King of Kong, which we'll talk about later. Now, when I actually did this, I was voicing it over, but I had a cold, and I had my Biff's Gaming Video shirt on. People kept coming up to me saying hi, a bunch of times, and I couldn't talk. I'm like, I can't talk. So the hand from hell will come up every now and then from here, pointing here and here. There's the hand from hell. So it was video games and pinball, arcade stuff. And as I walk you around the whole place here, I'll show you different areas. So people brought their own machines in, and they were either to play or to sell. Over to the left here was a raffle, you can get some things, and there's a video game store in Orlando right there. They were trying to sell some stuff, and here was a Pong unit, which is really, really, really cool. If you take a look at it, it's a physical Pong, where like it's like 3D, where there's stuff that it's like, come on, it's not a video screen as much as it's really cool. I'm taking a look at it, and over here there were broken machines, and I used to fix those when I worked at Tilt Game Room and Showbiz Pizza Place back in the day. I used to fix video games and pinball machines, although I wasn't really good at it. Over here was Atari Age, and they had a bunch of homebrew kind of stuff. The Atari 5200 and 7800 and 2600 and all that. That, I guess they're acting as distributors, and so they have certain games that are the ones that are distributing them. There was a DJ with a front screen projection there, and you could sit there and watch stuff. Now later this was used for a Street Fighter tournament. Now around the entire place you had different computers that were networked. You had rows of pinball, rows of video games. You had a console section. You have areas where people were selling stuff. So there was a little bit of everything. This section here was pinballs, and these were Pac-Man section. Some guys wanted to sell their stuff, so they purposely brought it in there. The people that brought it in there were there in case it broke, and they would set these machines up on free play. Now, the very center of this room was giant Tron, giant Star Wars, giant Donkey Kong, and you could go up there. If you take a look, you'll see the size of a regular standard arcade unit and the Tron one here. The Tron one was huge. It was like 20 feet tall. You can't even get this in your front door, so I don't know who had this or how they got it, but you have to have like a pretty big place for this. Now this whole place was the size of a regular arcade. Nothing, it wasn't too big, it was nothing special. About the size of, let's say, the Pinball Museum in Las Vegas. So over here, you had some guys, the two Stevens that I like to call them, because if you take a look at their names, They're actually spelled differently. Steven and Stefan. So it's a two Stefans. And they were trying to set the high score on Mario Brothers. Don't know if they actually did, but they were there all day long, sitting there playing their stuff. Now, if you take a look at some of these games like Hook, oh my God, that movie was so bad. And I guess they had some deals with these companies before it came out, and it's like, oh man, how do we, this movie really sucked. Flash Gordon, King of the Universe. And so there was a guy over here that was just sitting there getting paid to just hang out in front of the large screen front projection. This whole section in this corner here had things like Doom, which was, this is Doom Host, but this is networked together, so if you wanted to play Doom with people. And they had other machines. This was the console section. Computers, consoles, that kind of stuff. A lot of these people are probably the ones that actually own them. They're sitting there. You see like the Atari 800 and the NES, Atari XEGS game system. There's Vectrex. There's an IBM PC. This is Xbox, the Virtual Boy, Dreamcast. I'm just looking at these. And over here you've got Xbox and GameCube and Atari Jaguar. I mean, there's tons and tons and tons. Now, at one point, I had basically everything that was in here. I didn't have all the monitors, but I had all the systems and just, I had 10, 15,000 games. I mean, I had just tons of stuff. I used to buy up video game stores, dumping out the inventory and turn around and flip them. But I had all of, and it had it in the boxes too, so I had all of this stuff mostly. So you take a look around. I don't know what this one row of stuff was there, where that came from. But the rest of the stuff, these were the people that they're sitting there playing to probably own them. So they'd get them for free. Ah! Got a lot of that. You'll see that over and over and over and over. The guys at an arcade game, it's always the game's fault. And remember the days where they'd have to load the game in on CD or DVD and it would just take a while. Not on cartridges, by the way. CD-based systems, you had the black screen there. Over here, you had some guys with Steel Battalion for the Xbox. This is a controller that I used to own this, and they were sitting there for several minutes trying to figure this out. I had to go up there and show them where the start was. They could not figure out how to start it. I know it because I played it, and I had the same issues. And, of course, Virtual Boy, which sucked. Which, by the way, it did give a 3D look. It was just all in red. And you had some other guys down there, and you could tell that, you know, he's like hanging out, you know, playing games like on the Jaguar there, and he goes over the Dreamcast, it looks like. So it was kind of a good thing for people that were into that kind of stuff. The entire show had more stuff. Everybody was trying to sell their goods. There were video game magazines, there were all sorts of stuff around the whole place. And as I do a walkthrough, you'll see on one row might be pinball machines, but that's probably from one guy that owned all that kind of stuff that brought them in there, and you had arcade video games. Some of these games you probably never heard of, some of you might have. Over here is this is Warlords. They had a section of Warlords, and here's a four-player Warlords. This is really cool. I wanted to get in on this. I wanted to push one of these kids out of the way and start playing, because we played that on the Atari 2600. We didn't even know it was in the arcades for years later. When I was a kid, we had the little paddles on the Atari VCS 2600, and we were playing that thing, and that was one of the best games for the 2600. Loved it. There were, I don't know how many games there were, but there were a lot of games you probably never heard of. Some of them you did. And as you walked around, this guy over here is just talking to people and selling things. And it's just more of the same wherever you go throughout the thing. So you just pick a game and you can go and play it. Now these things were on free play. Sometimes they would run out of free play if they had had a 99 credits, it would run out or got unplugged. So the guy would come over and redo it. So some of the games were broken. But the guys that owned them were probably around somewhere because they get in for free if they do that. They didn't have to pay their $35 like I had to pay. Now Atari was the king of the vector graphic games. You know, Black Widow, Tempest, all these games were great at the time. So you had these guys, oh man, blah, blah. Got a lot of that. It's the game, it's just the programmer. And some of these, what is this game? I never even heard of this game. I mean, you gotta get MAME out to play some of this stuff. And you have your little X-Arcade joystick, which by the way, some of the games you have to play in the arcades, like Tron or Defender, because of the joysticks or the buttons. Even games like Joust, which I had on the Atari 8-bit computer back in the day, it was my favorite 8-bit game, was Joust. And light gun games, you know, you really can't play them. You can on MAME, but it's not the same. So people that have some of these games, I don't know why they're playing them, whether because they've never heard of them or because they really liked them or remember them. Some of these games I don't even remember are the ones I do. Now, it was something for the whole family. You know, dads could bring out their kids and play. And, man, jeez. Freaking programmers, it's not my fault. I'm a great player. What is this? You know, the force wasn't with this guy. But if he got a haircut, he would have played a lot better. This guy over at the Pac-Man machine, now he has a haircut, and he's doing the high score. Now, playing a two-player light gun is really cool. Just go in there with your friend, boom, 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 boom. And that's one of the newer games that are meant to get many quarters. And here's someone that is pressing the little button at the bottom to get the 99 credits because it ran out. It's not really a button. The coin slot has got a little, it's kind of like a paper clip at the bottom where the coin goes through. And I used to fix these, by the way. And so you just press them over and over and over and over and over. And there's space, zap, 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 zap. These were the mini arcades over there. They were different sizes. You had the full-blown ones, you had the minis, you had cocktails. So you had different versions of these back in the day. And here you've got a pinball machine right next to a video game, which is kind of cool. I mean, they're right next to each other. And then over here, you had the Street Fighter II contest. And these guys, I mean, these guys were fanatics, man. They're sitting there, boom, 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 boom. It was wild. Now, I was never really in the Street Fighter. This was, you know, my college days, I guess, or after college, or somewhere around there. Whatever. So these guys over here actually design games. So what you're going to have is a guy named Rupert from Burnout Game Ventures, and he's going to be showing a game called Not Without You by Adventure Board and Major Games.
So these are our clients. That's my company. They develop the game. We provide all the talent, the resources, the processes, and the kick in the ass they need in order to create quality games as much as possible. It's a 2D puzzle game that these little critters here are called Pilcro, and they've been kidnapped by a mad scientist, and we got to help them escape. So we go to the lab. This game will have 60 levels. We're getting ready to release it on iOS, Android, and Steam. The key is these critters, they all move in unison. So you use the arrow keys, and you have to use the environment to position them so that they can all escape simultaneously. So it starts out real easy, but by level 9, you're pulling your hair out. developed in a few months by a team of people that were from Full Sail and UCF and a few other schools. And we have 24 of the top advisors in the world that work with them on a daily basis to teach them and mentor them. Our goal is to create 50 sustainable game companies in the next 5 years. So right now, our game companies are averaging 3 years old, so I'd like to think we know what we're doing in that regard.
Now, Rupert has a company called Burnout Game Ventures in Orlando, Florida, where he distributes and incubates video game companies. It was really, really, really cool. Over here, you see guys trying to get pictures with Billy Mitchell. I mean, really? Anyways, over here you've got Free Play Florida. They're selling their stuff. They should just give you a t-shirt for $35. I mean, $25 for a t-shirt? Seriously? I mean, yeah, I could see it, but just give me a t-shirt. Now, in the middle over here, you had other companies selling their stuff. This section here, if you wanted to make an arcade system, you could buy the parts. I guess all the things you needed, for example, the stickers on the side and the layouts for where the different pieces would go. So you buy them, I guess this is some type of Raspberry Pi or Arduino or something like that running MAME. That's what these companies, they're just selling their stuff, and this guy's over here selling pictures, which, artwork, which was really cool. Now, George Lowe, which we'll get to later, funny guy, stand-up comedian, this guy who is the voice of Space Ghost, he never stops. He's hilarious. Now, some of the games were for sale. You know, if you wanted to buy them, you could buy them. Now, the King of Quarters had Billy Mitchell and Walter Day from 2007. The guy on the left is Walter Day, and the guy on the right is Billy Mitchell. And the guy, look, that was a weird stare. These guys are selling their photos for $10 and the movie for $20. It's a documentary that came out in 2007. It was just a documentary, guys. Now, the thing with the Twin Galaxies is Walter Day had an arcade in Iowa called Twin Galaxies from 1981 to 1984, and then it closed. He's a college dropout, but he was on the cover of Time magazine in 1982 because he set up high scoring system, and he called Iowa the video game capital of the world. Dude, have you ever heard of Silicon Valley? Nobody even knows where Iowa is. I can't even put it on a map. And Billy Mitchell is from Florida. He's from Hollywood, Florida. He has Ricky's World Famous Restaurant, which I guess his parents gave him this restaurant, so I don't know how it's world famous, but it's just like a regular bar. It's no big deal. I mean, it just doesn't even have a Pac-Man or Donkey Kong machine in it. It was just like a bar. And the food was okay. It was like a regular bar, no big deal. These two guys were still going at it throughout the day. He's like, I'm going to do it again. Let's go. Come on. So Billy Mitchell's up here trying to get 0 points at Donkey Kong. Oh, no, man. Let's do it again. I don't get the tie. He's always got an American tie. Now, here's my thing. Ice hockey. When I was at Tilt Game Room, particularly Showbiz Pizza Place, I played ice hockey every single day and air hockey. The reason is because they broke, quote unquote, so I'd have to play them to fix them. And I don't think in all the time I worked there, several years, I ever lost a game of ice hockey, and I only lost a couple games of air hockey in my life. I mean, that's how good I was. Then you had the very, very, very old school pinball machines. Now, these are museum quality stuff. An argument can be made that like any pinball machines could be in a museum, but these are like carnival, turn of the century kind of super old, super rare ones. they did have these little plaques on it explaining what they are. If you take a look at them, you see they're made out of wood. I mean, this is like pre-World War II kind of stuff. And really, really, really old. A couple of them did have lights that came up on them, which is kind of cool. But most of them were just these very mechanical kind of machines that whoever has this, had these, he probably owns all of them and brought them all of them there at once. He probably, some rich guy or something, has them somewhere. But these belong in a museum. But someday I want to open up a video game and computer and pinball museum somewhere, International Drive in Orlando. So if you're someone like Bill Gates or someone who wants to donate a couple of bucks, come talk to me because I want to do it. Now, I just watched Star Wars recently, and I watched all three of them. And let me tell you, Star Wars had continuity errors up the yin-yang. After they did episodes 1, 2, and 3, it just, the continuity just completely messed up. Now back over in the pinball era, they had a section of these for sale, which probably means they came from the same guy. They had restoration company there where you could restore an old machine or rebuild them, which is kind of cool. Oh, hey, get out of the way. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. The lady in the red, thank you for getting out of the way really quickly. Most of these guys are coming up bumping me while I'm recording over and over and over. Thank you, ma'am. Now, some of these machines were broken, so I thought I would show you the inside of the machine. Pinball machines have a lot of parts. Video game machines, like I used to have an old Atari X&O four-player video game with trackballs and everything, and it's very basic and simple. Now, that one had extras because of the trackballs. You take a look at this, there's PCBs, there's motherboards, there's cables going everywhere, there's this, there's that, there's everything. And this guy here probably owns this other machine that broke, and he's there fixing it. He's like an old school engineer type. And he probably has, you know, a bunch of these at home, and he's got all the parts, which is really cool, you know? I mean, he's got his own little museum probably at home. Now, Hyperball, really, really, really cool. Not to play it, but just to shoot things. By the way, sound effects are extra. You don't get any more. But Hyperball is one of those games that's really, really cool to watch and to play. Now, for a minute, but it gets really old. The actual gameplay isn't great, but the actual shooting is really kind of cool. It's a neat concept. Now, there was another area down the hall which had several areas, and this was a panel area that's mostly about pinball, and other guys were coming in here, booksellers and so forth.
We had any kind of amount of stock in the building that we hadn't sold games, so the demand is there. I think, you know, I often wonder, and there are other people in my company a lot smarter than me to figure this stuff out. You know, if I had a bakery, I don't have any loaves of rye bread to bake today, you know, I'd probably be throwing all kinds of stuff.
So going down the hallway here, you go to the right, you have the pinball tournament area. This was an area set up different from the pinball machines out in the main area where people were playing these pinball machines, and they had a computer there with the high scores on them, and you would just go playing. You'd sign up, and let me tell you, these guys, look at the woman to the left with the purple hair. So these guys were dang good. Now, they were spread out, which is really what you wanted, because you don't want to be crammed together like the main area. So when you went into this area, it was separated. You could only be in the pinball tournament. So they had newer ones like World Poker Tour, and they had like really, 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 really old ones as well. Not the turn of the century ones, but they had old ones. So it was a combination of some of these. For example, the one in the middle here, you take a look at that. That's, you know, that's a pretty old one. You could tell sort of by the top part up there. And so people were just playing them and playing them and playing them. It's just a pinball machine, ma'am. That's all it is. Ah, jeez. Ah, stupid pinball. Damn. What's this guy jumping for, man? Come on. That should be a penalty. That should be 15 yards personal foul on the pinball machine, dude. That's not even a tilt. What is that? So it looks like there weren't many people here, and there weren't, but this was like through the weekend. So people came and went, and they had different machines like Aerosmith and 8-Ball and Gorgar. And if you see with the points that they were getting and the scores, now this wasn't the final scores, but this is the time I shot it, the scores that they actually had. So they were bringing these scores together and seeing who was the best, and I guess that's why you can, you know, win prizes and so forth, which I guess is kind of cool. If you're into that kind of stuff, you can say that you won first place at this tournament or whatever.
When you guys are going to pick a game, is that something totally up to you guys, or is a manufacturer coming to you saying, hey, we got a movie coming up we want to do a game of, or is it fan-based? How do you guys decide, design-wise, what you're going to do?
Title, right. It can go either way. If I saw something right, I'm going to stand by this, okay? I walked around when we were talking about doing AC/DC, only Lyman and I were talking about it.
So down the hallway, there was this maker room. The stuff that's in here is like in a downtown library in downtown Orlando kind of stuff. They had a 3D printer and how to solder and build stuff. So that's all this was. This is mostly for the kids. If you go over to the left, they had, button makers. So here's a 3D printer that takes like 100 hours to make the smallest thing. They got to speed that up someday. And then over here you had how to make a button thing, and they had guys soldering. I just learned how to solder a few months ago at the library downtown Orlando. And let me tell you, the solders are hot. You gotta watch it. You can't be talking to people. You gotta watch it, man. It's hot, I'm telling you. Told you. You don't wanna listen. You don't wanna listen. Over here, they had a Raspberry Pi set up, probably with MAME, and you could build your own arcade stuff, the controllers, or a portable one. I'm against this, not against Dig Dug. I played Dig Dug for a long time when I was there. That's the main game I played. But I'm against them doing this because this is really piracy, because they didn't really design these games. They're basically stealing them. But that's another issue. So here is Space Ghost Coast to Coast Live, and here was one of the people they were interviewing.
And the undisputed Street Fighter, a 30-year retrospective. So, let's put your hands together for Tim Lepetino! So, how are you enjoying the free play so far?
Very well, very well. No brack sightings, I feel good about it.
Cool. Yeah, it's a lot of fun out there. We got a lot of action, a lot of noise. So much noise I can't even hear myself think. It's all bouncing around inside this cap of mine. All right. So, now I understand that you're a real big Atari fan. So, exactly how old were you when you got your first Atari?
39.
And they laughed, and they laughed, and they laughed, and they laughed some more. A good time was had by all. And then George Lowe was the main guy coming in. He was the voice of Space Ghost on the cartoon series. And this guy was funny. I'm telling you, really, really funny.
This is a performer. He is a voice actor. And he has starred in such things as Aqua Teens and Hunger Force. Are they the same thing? Or was... And also on something called Robot Chicken. Woo! Woo! Sounds like a villain that I beat up once. So let's give it up for George Lowe.
It's not medical. Hello there.
Okay.
Hey kids, look at me. I'm up past my bedtime. How about that? Hi, Spacey.
Greetings.
What's happening?
Oh,
kinds of
things. I had a bad trip to the ear doctor the other day, so if I miss anything, I'll just ask you again. They sucked out the part of my brain that does long division.
And so that was Free Play Florida 2017, right around the time of Thanksgiving at Doubletree Hilton in Orlando. It was expensive, but hey, it was kind of fun. It was a whole weekend kind of thing that you could go and play arcade games, video games, and pinball machines, and it was a blast.